فعاش القلب إخلاصا وصرت تحوم كالطير تحلق في ثقافات وتنهل من ربى الخير.
Welcome everyone into the mosque, and all the doors, as you can see, are glass. So anyone driving or walking past the street can see exactly what we're doing inside the mosque. It's a welcoming place, transparency, nothing to hide. And that's why, alhamdulillah, in the last year, tens of people literally entered Islam into this mosque, and inshallah, more to come. The ceiling of the mosque is a special feature, have 96 gold-painted lanterns. And these lanterns allow light to change its color throughout the day naturally. So throughout the day, as the sun is moving, the light in the mosque changes naturally. And the light coming from the ceiling means the light coming from the pond behind me. So it's a beautiful environment. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it an avenue for da'wah inshallah. Now, welcoming our great and very special guest for the night. And it's not an easy task to be assigned to introduce our beloved Mufti. But our beloved Mufti has a beautiful name as well. His name is Mufti Ismail bin Musa Ming. MashaAllah, have two names of prophets in his name. He is the Grand Mufti of Zimbabwe, a beautiful African country. The Sheikh of the Mufti holds a degree in Islam of Islamic Sharia from Islamic Medina, Islamic University of Medina. He also continued his studies in Islamic jurisprudence in India and had many other qualifications, degrees and things that he has published. The Sheikh is with us tonight, Sheikh. I hope we can take the audience here and the audience in the day yesterday as a testimony of the love that Muslims in Victoria Australia have for you. And on my behalf, on behalf of everyone here, I would like to tell you that we love you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only. And our Prophet has taught us that if you love someone, you go to him and tell him we love you. Oh Sheikh, we love you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But we ask Allah to resurrect us with you and the Prophet and Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, in the highest levels of paradise. Brothers and sisters, I'm not going to waste one more second. With all due respect, I would like to introduce Mufti Ismail bin Musa Ming.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Bismillah wa alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. My brothers, my sisters, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we send blessings upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his household companions. We ask Allah to bless them, to bless every one of you, to bless the ummah at large, to bless humanity, to grant us goodness, to protect us from evil, to help us through the difficulties that we face throughout our lives, and to grant us all ease. Ameen. My brothers and sisters, in the same way that you say you love me for the sake of Allah, I promise you that I love you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I see the faces here and I forget how hot it is. I see the faces here and I forget all the negatives, because you know what? The biggest positive is that we are seated here in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Unique, amazing, awesome place. Absolutely awesome. May Allah build for every single person who has put in a single dollar towards the house of his, an entire house of Jannah al-Firdaws. So now, you want to get a dua like that for you, we need to put a dollar into the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by this will. I always tell people that, you know, if you were to pay for using the facility at the masjid that you happen to lead salah in, a dollar for every salah, I promise you the problems of the ummah would be resolved, the salary of the imam would increase, and a lot of our children would want to become imams, subhanAllah. Because the imam would be driving an S-class, perhaps. S-600, mashallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us. The point I'm raising is, we use facilities sometimes that are paid for by someone else, and we're wealthy in our own right. Would you ever consider donating, putting something into a box here, thinking to yourself, I use the facility, let me put in a dollar, $2? The problem is sometimes we take it for granted. Please consider this, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who, when we use a facility, the water, the carpets, the electricity, everything else, we can at least contribute towards it at some stage. I wish to continue, inshallah, from the topic that I started yesterday about Ulul Albab. Several places, and one of them is in Surah Yusuf, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talk, you can always catch it on muslimcentral.com. If you go and search for that talk, inshallah, you will find it after today, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Today I wish to kick off with the story or something that I want to derive from the story of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam. And there is a reason why I'm doing this, and I'll explain to you. But before I do that, remember when we are saying I'm going to talk about the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam, I'm not going to mention the entire story because that would need a whole lifetime. I'm going to tell you just a few points, and we want to learn lessons, perhaps certain points that we want to derive to help us today, here and now. Like for example, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wassalam was one of the most gifted by Allah. He was one of the most gifted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When I see a large crowd of people, I get worried. Why? Because it's a huge responsibility. I am just like you. This afternoon I delivered a talk entitled My Favorite Sheikh at the Alam Masjid. That talk is also available online. If you hear that talk, I dedicated the entire 25 minutes to explain to the people that I am one of you. Nothing makes me better than you. Perhaps you may be better than me. It's just that I happen to remind you about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you know what? I need to be even more careful. Because when I remind you, I need to ask myself, am I actually practicing what I preach? May Allah strengthen us all and make us all indeed from among those who can become better people as the days pass. Ameen. So, subhanAllah, why do I get so worried? One is it's a responsibility. Two, the messengers of Allah, whom Allah loves so much, sometimes very, very few people actually accepted that message. Do you realize this? Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam came out, was sent by Allah. He delivered the message. Do you know that initially, very, very few people, perhaps according to some narrations, just two people accepted his message. SubhanAllah. One was his wife, one was his nephew. SubhanAllah. According to some of the narrations, Lut alayhi salam. According to some of the narrations, his wife, him, and that's it. The rest of them, the father, the others, they didn't even accept the message. So I want to tell you, sometimes numbers does not necessarily mean that you are right. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us these. As for us, we are fortunate, we are just following the footsteps of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If I tell you something that Allah has said, I'm doing a good job. If I tell you something Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, I'm doing a good job. If I'm bringing you closer to Allah and His Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I'm doing a good job. The minute I bring you closer to anything else or to myself, I'm doing a bad job. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all and grant us all success in the dunya and the akhirah. Amen. So, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam was young. Before his prophethood, he started asking questions. He was asking questions to his father. Right, I want to stop there for a moment because this is Ibrah li ulil ajbab. Okay, that's what we are saying. It's lessons for those who have sound minds. So, what was he asking his folks? He began to say, listen, my father is carving the idols, my father is worshipping this, and he is worshipping that, and he is doing this. I want to engage in a discussion with this father of mine because I don't understand why he is doing what he is doing. So, he started asking questions. From this I learned that it's only normal and natural for people to ask questions when they don't understand. Don't get upset when someone asks you a question. Brother, why are you doing this? Can you explain it to me? Shut up. I don't want to explain to you. You just do it. Because I've seen other people doing it, I'm going to do it. If you say that, you have failed. You have failed. SubhanAllah. But if you engage them, you try and understand it, you don't know, you go and learn and come back, even if it is your own child. Many of us lose our children sometimes because we don't have answers for them. We do things and we know we are right, but we don't know why we are doing it. SubhanAllah. That means you need to increase your knowledge. If you want to preserve your deen, you need to increase your knowledge of the deen. If your knowledge is not increased, you will not be able to preserve the deen. Remember that. The ilm and the knowledge is the most important thing. قُلْ هَذِهِ سَبِيلِي أَدْعُو إِلَى اللَّهِ عَلَى بَصِيرَةٍ أَنَا وَمَنِ اتَّبَعَنِي وَسُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُشْرِكِينَ. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to say, this is my path. I call towards Allah, myself and those who follow me with sound knowledge. Al-Basira here refers to that which was from Allah in terms of knowledge and revelation. We use revelation in order to call people towards goodness. How are you going to do that if you don't have the knowledge of the deen? So, inshallah, I hope we all make an intention we're going to increase our knowledge, inshallah. You know, when there are lessons in the masjid, please try and attend. MashaAllah, we have a beautiful masjid. I promise you, the concrete here is going to bear witness for you or against you. I promise you, the walls here will bear witness for you or against you. I promise you, the spot upon which you lay your head to be in prostration for Allah will bear witness for you or against you. So make sure that you make use of the facility and make sure that you worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, if you don't worship Allah, one of the scariest things that I've come across is a verse of the Quran where Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala,
تتولوا يستبدل قوما غيركم ثم لا يكونوا أمثالكم.
If you are going to turn away, if you are going to turn away from the obedience of Allah, from worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you know what? Allah says, we will replace you with others who will not be like you. So you want to go away, the loss is yours, not ours. That's what Allah is saying. If you don't worship me, Allah says, no problem, we will bring others who will worship us. SubhanAllah. So if we don't make an effort towards getting closer to Allah, there are others who are making an effort towards getting closer to Allah. I want to pause for a moment and give you an example. I visited Nigeria, and I visited some other West African countries. And I promise you, I was shocked at what I saw in a pleasant way. I was surprised pleasantly. It was something I didn't expect, and I saw the masajid being full for Salat al-Fajr in some parts of the country. And I've seen people towards the north, the way they study the Quran, the way they learn it, the amount of importance they give to it is amazing. And I told myself, subhanAllah, when you hear Nigeria, what do you think? I don't even want you to answer that question. When you hear Nigeria, what do you think? I promise you, if you travel to that country and to the northern part of the country, you will change your mind, subhanAllah. There are some people who are so powerful in their being that it makes us feel like we are so weak. And yet, when we sit and listen to the name of the country, we think, you know what, you better watch out. There are a lot of con artists there. There are a lot of people who might be doing this and that. No, that's actually a misunderstanding. Every country has good and bad. Every place has those who are dedicated, and there will be some who may be criminal. I mean, today I was passing around and we were speaking about the jails. You know, there is one area here that is built on a land that perhaps might have been a prison a long time back. Am I right? Am I right? So, thinking about it, you know, for me it would be a little bit spooky to purchase there, but it's okay. I'm thinking to myself, wow, prisoners, the prison was quite big, man. How many Muslims would be in there? Oh, the number of Muslims is growing in there, subhanAllah. Is that true? I hope it's not true. I hope it's not true. Come on, come on. We need to do better than that. We need to do better. What did we learn? Let's be honest. While we are pointing fingers at others, we are busy losing our own children and family members to crime. That's not true. That shouldn't be the case. We need to be honest, upright people. Learn the deen, put it into practice, be concerned about conveying it to others. I promise you, you lead a happy life. We are searching for contentment and happiness, but the problem is, the solution is dangling in front of us and we're heading elsewhere. That's the thing. Allah tells you, you want contentment? Come to my house, where you wash yourself correctly and say, Allahu Akbar, and you will achieve so much contentment. You're just so calm. Everything is left behind with your shoes at the back there. You know, subhanAllah. Your shoes. I can imagine how many shoes there are at the back. Good luck to everyone looking for your shoes when you're done. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant you peace. If you don't find them, don't worry. It's a good sign because that means you left all your problems. So my brothers and sisters, it's amazing how we have the solution of our problems in salah. Salah is a plugin with Allah, your maker. But we don't make salah, we still want to solve our problems. How? You need to first pray yourself, call out to Allah, He is the owner of the solution. SubhanAllah, come, fulfill your prayer. If you've been weak or the masjid is a little bit far, at least start it at home, but don't miss a prayer. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us punctual. Say Ameen. And I hope that was a genuine Ameen, because you know what, sometimes we sit and we say, okay, inshallah, in my mind, you know, inshallah. Do you know what inshallah means? What does inshallah mean? Can someone tell me? If Allah wills. So now, sometimes when people say inshallah, that means that I don't want to do it. But you say inshallah, that means yes, I will do it. So is it one of those or one of these, inshallah? Inshallah. Mashallah, mashallah. May Allah make us steadfast. So, my brothers and sisters, we become more conscious of that, because you know there were messengers sent to us. We are fortunate, like I said, we have Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, he spoke about us to his companions. Do you know that? Do you know what he told them? He said, there will come people from my ummah who have not seen me, but they will believe in me. Subhanallah, see me. Subhanallah. We are the ones. We believe in him firmly. That he was the messenger of Allah. He was the final. He was the best of creation, the most noble of prophets. We haven't seen him. But our belief and conviction is solid. No one can shake it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep that and make it even more solid. Ameen. So, we are fortunate that we are part of this ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Prophets worked so hard at the, in the initial stages, they struggled. Now, people say, you know what? I'm living in a nation where it's becoming a little bit embarrassing to be a Muslim. The reason is, a lot of Muslims, you know, sometimes they do a few things here and there, and it's not really helping me because, you know, we're getting a bad name. So what do I do? I think I'll just decide to, fit in a way that I can just change my whole identity. I don't need to really come to the masjid. I don't need to say my name is Abdul Aziz anymore. What's your name? My name is Zizi. Okay, fine. Okay. So what else? You know? And we just give in. And you've given in. And subhanAllah, okay, fair enough. Do you know that if you claim that you're going to be a Muslim, and if you are a real Muslim, Allah's going to test that. Allah says, well, we're going to test you. How? Well, people are going to look at you funny. Is that going to change you? If it didn't, subhanAllah, you're not heading in the right direction. If it didn't, then you're going to make a difference, because more and more people will look at you and say, I want to be like that, subhanAllah. I want to be like that. You know, they see the calmness of the people walking to the masjid, and amazing, they want to be like that. I can give you a true story. There's a sister who told me that, you know, the smile, we talk about smiling, mashallah, you got a smile, right? Everyone's smiling. Are we smiling, inshallah? Yeah, we are. Alhamdulillah. When you smile, subhanAllah, it's an act of charity. It's an act of charity. Subhanallah. So the sister was saying, when she goes to work with all the other sisters, and she's sitting around, she always tries to smile, even if she's had a bad morning, or even if she hasn't been feeling too well, but she'll smile. And she says, there were these people, these fellow sisters who were looking at her every time, but they were not Muslim. And they spoke to each other, saying, you know, this sister here, she's always smiling, she's always happy. And they went to her and told her, what's the secret, you know? And she says, you know, I'm a Muslim, I'm supposed to be happy all the time, smiling. And it drew two of them towards the deen, and they entered the fold of Islam through a smile. Through a smile. Don't underestimate the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A lot of us look so upset that when people see us, they're like, oh, no way. Even if they didn't have problems, you feel like you don't know the problems. Because of the face that you see, you know? Just crunch it up. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us. When someone looks at you, they should feel to themselves that, you know what? MashaAllah, I don't want to be like this. Man, positive all the time. That's a mu'min. That's the belief. عَجَبًا لِأَمْرِ الْمُؤْمِنِ فَإِنَّ أَمْرَهُ كُلَّهُ لَهُ خَيْرٍ. The hadith says, you know, the affairs of a believer are amazing. All the time they are good. Something negative happens, he bears patience, it's better for him. Something positive happens, he thanks Allah, it's positive for him. So my brothers and sisters, remember that. It's very, very important. We will be able to spread the deen, and we won't be replaced. Won't be replaced. So I was telling you, sometimes when we don't come, you don't realize there are people in Africa who might be filling that gap. Subhanallah. How many of us read the Quran every day? A few days ago I came across an app, an application in my mobile phone. Someone sent it to me. It's in the Arabic language. It's an application called Nahtim. Remember that word, Nahtim, right? You can search for it. It's in the Arabic language. And that application has been downloaded by millions of people. And what do they do? What does it do for you? Every time you touch your phone, and how many times do you touch your phone, guys? I like you touching it right now, right? So, every time you touch your phone, before you get into it, it makes you read a verse of the Quran, one verse. And you know who finishes the Quran the quickest? The youngsters, mashallah. Because then you go, I'm going to read this verse. Okay. What does Allah say? Allah says this, then you open your phone. Then you open your phone. So, it's interesting. I know there might be some cheats, but it's okay. At least you have
something reminding you to say, listen, we're going to read the Quran. I want to ask you a question. How many of you, and you can answer it within yourself, how many of you read the Quran on a daily basis? I think we're going to only have about 5% of us. I promise you I'm not joking, 5% of us. Every day you open it and you read one verse or two, minimum one or a little bit more. How many of us? We are guilty. We are guilty. Wallahi, we are guilty. If I were to ask you to show me hands, I would be embarrassed, you would be embarrassed. So inshallah I won't. But I will tell you, please make a difference. One verse. How much? One verse a day. Is it too much? No. One verse a day. One, just one. Start with that. I promise you your life will change. You know why? It is Kalamullah. It is the word of Allah. You get excited when someone's coming to talk to you, but you're not excited about the word of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is Allah's word that you're supposed to be more excited about. It is amazing, the most truthful word in existence, the best, the most powerful, the highest, the one that Allah says, قَدْ جَاءَتْكُمْ مَوْعِظَةٌ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ وَشِفَاءٌ لِمَا فِي الصُّدُورِ وَهُدًى وَرَحْمَةٌ. Allah describes that book and the Quran with these beautiful words that Allah has sent for you, O believers. A reminder from your Lord. It has in it a reminder, the Quran. It's a reminder for you and I. And it has any cure for the diseases of the heart. We're all looking for cure. We all want our hearts to be good and pure. We all want cure even regarding our physical diseases and sicknesses. The Quran has the cure. Do you know that? The verses of the Quran are so powerful that when you read them, your body becomes healthy. How's that? Subhanallah. Your body becomes healthy. People have done it. You read Ayatul Kursi, what will it do for you? It will protect you, subhanAllah. You read the Mu'awwidat, the last two surahs of the Quran, what does it do for you? It protects you from evil, from the evil eye, from jinn, from shaitan, from black magic, from whatever else. What world on earth can do that for you besides the Quran, subhanAllah? And we don't read the Quran on a daily basis, then we complain, oh Shaykh, I'm seeing things. I'm seeing things. Now look, back in my country, things is the name of like a crisp. You know, they call it things. So it's also, I'm seeing things. You say, oh, well, you know, did you buy them? What did you do? No, I'm seeing things. Okay. You read the Quran? The answer is no. Subhanallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. You know, talking about things, one of the sheikhs here, mashallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless all our mashayikh and all the brothers and sisters, mashallah. So he sends me a message and he says, please can you come to my place? So I thought, subhanAllah, yeah, you know, but when I was in Sydney, one of the sheikhs there told me that, you know, there is such and such a sheikh and you should go to visit, you know, the center. I didn't know that the question I was about to ask him was irrelevant or wrong, because I told him, please can you tell me where is your place? And yet the name of the place was my place. Allahu Akbar. My place. I think there's a center here called my place, am I right? Oh, my center, yeah. So he says, please can you come to my center? I said, where is your center? My center, subhanAllah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So my center, inshallah, my center. But now it's become our center by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that was a question I asked him because I was ignorant. I didn't know. Had I known better, I would have realized, you know what? When you say my center, you're talking of a specific place. So if you increase your knowledge, you start learning things. When you read the Quran, you get closer to Allah. When you read the Quran, it brings you towards fulfilling the other duties that you have unto Allah, such as your salah. A person who's regular with salah, there is a link between them and Allah in such a unique way that when sin comes in front of them, they won't want to commit it. You know why? Because Allah says, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ تَنْهَى عَنِ الْفَحْشَاءِ وَالْمُنْكَرِ. Salah itself will prohibit you from immorality and vice, evil. Salah stops you from committing evil. If you read Salah al-Fajr and you're worried about Dhuhr, between the two you're not going to go and commit a sin. When you read Dhuhr and you're worried about Salah al-Asr because now you need to read Asr, you're not going to commit sin in the middle. You read Asr, you know before you know it is Maghrib, and when you read Maghrib you know that before you know it is going to be Salah al-Isha. Subhanallah. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us regularity with Salah, to make us more serious so that it keeps us away from the other sins. Now,
Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, very, very early in his life, was asking questions. Like I said, when your children ask you questions, don't throw those questions aside. Don't embarrass them. Don't make them think, you know what, why are you asking this? They can ask you the silliest things. It's okay. Take it. If you don't know, say inshallah, tomorrow, get you the answer. Or inshallah, we'll ask the Shaykh because I want to show myself. Subhanallah. Or we will ask someone else, there's no harm. You don't need to pretend like you know the answer for everything. You know, you might be a scholar, I might be a person who knows a little bit, so many things I don't know. I'm not embarrassed when someone asks me, what is this? I say, I really don't know. I'm not too sure. I need to find out. There's nothing wrong in that answer. It's a good answer. So you can say that to your own children, but answer them, help them, go out, research, learn, and you will be able to help your children, inshallah, maintain that strength in the deen. Then Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, he decides, you know what? I've already knocked out my dad when it comes to the argument, and I need to just tell him something. So he says, Ya abati inni qad ja'ani min al-ilm ma lam yahdika fattabi'ni ahdika siratan sawiya. Oh my father, knowledge has come to me that did not come to you. Follow me, I'll guide you to the right path. Now he's advising his father. The father refused to take that advice. The father says, hey, who do you think you are? If you don't stop what you're saying and what you're doing, I'm going to punish you. I'm going to penalize you. Subhanallah. That was the wrong way of responding. From this I learned that sometimes you can get advice from someone younger than you. If they are right, they are right. Take it. Take it. Sometimes your son can correct you. Your daughter can come and tell you, you know what? Dad, mom, I think you guys are wrong. And if you are, don't be proud and arrogant to deny it and say, no, I'm not wrong, I'm right. Hang on. If they've proven that you're wrong. Subhanallah. A lot of the times we fail because Allah sends someone to correct us younger than us, and we're too proud to accept the correction. So what we do, we prefer to choose failure over being corrected. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us a beautiful lesson. Look at this. Allah mentions it in the Quran, but we are drawing a lesson for ourselves to say, listen, Ibrahim ulil albab. It's a lesson for those with sound intellect to say, this is what happened at the time, and here it is. Subhanallah. This is Ibrahim alayhi salam. I want to throw one more example from his life. He was concerned so much about his progeny, those to follow up to Qiyamah. I don't know if you hear me talk sometimes when I start, I say, may Allah bless you and bless your offspring, those to come up to the end of time or up to Qiyamah. Subhanallah. Some people say, hey, you're making a dua, man. Well, that's like far away. I need to be blessed first. Come on, man. You know, subhanallah. Like sometimes, you know, when someone makes a dua and they say, may Allah grant your offspring rizq. You say, but what about me? Subhanallah. Your offspring is a sign of rizq as well, you know. It's like when we say, okay, I want you all to say Ameen. May Allah bless you with offspring. Ameen. So many of you are not married. So when you say may Allah bless you with offspring, it includes in it, may Allah give me a good spouse. Wow. It's all inclusive, two in one, you know. So what happens is when you say may Allah bless you with pious offspring, offspring will be the coolest of your eyes. It includes those who don't have children, may Allah give you children. Those who are not married, may Allah give you a spouse and then children. Subhanallah. So now you say, may Allah give you rich children. What will happen? He has to first get you married, then he has to get you children, then he has to make them rich. So just say, I mean, what does it cost you? MashaAllah. But remember, the richness needs to be the dunya and the akhirah. Not just richness in the dunya, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us goodness. So, my brothers and sisters, Ibrahim alayhi salam, as dua is made mention of in Surah Al-Baqarah and in a few other places where he says, Rabbana waj'alna muslimayn laka. وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً لَكَ. Oh Allah, the two of us, my son Ismail and myself, make us submitters unto you. And you know what? Not just the two of us. From our offspring, those to come after us, the two of us, make them also those who will submit unto you. What happened? They were serious about the dua. Allah gave it to them. Allah gave it to them. Ibrahim alayhi salam was tested so much by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one after the other. I'm not going to talk about his tests today because there are so many, and inshallah, I'm sure you know quite a few of them. The Prophet Ibrahim, alayhi salam, he was tested so much, he passed all those tests. As a result, Allah became so happy with him, Allah said to us, وَاتَّخَذَ اللَّهُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ خَلِيلًا. Allah has taken Ibrahim as a very close friend. Now, Khalil is the highest level of friendship you can have, is al-khulla. It's friendship of a very high level. Allah says Ibrahim is a very close friend of ours. For your information, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is also known as Khalilullah. He's also a close friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, how did he become so close? When Allah tested him, he did not become angry. He did not become upset with Allah. He never questioned Allah. Brothers and sisters, every day things will happen that are not according to what we want. Because Allah is in charge, Allah is in control. Be happy with what Allah has chosen for you. Did you try your best? Yes, I did. Well, then I'm happy with what transpired. If you did not try your best, you share the blame. Because for example, you want to pass in the examination, you want to get a job, but you haven't applied properly, you haven't worked hard and got off your bed and go to look for jobs, and then you think you're sitting on the bed blaming Allah, oh Allah, I didn't get a job. Allah says, I gave you energy, I gave you everything, I gave you the capacity. You only have to get up and go next door to apply for the job. You didn't do that, now you're blaming me. Subhanallah. You want to pass your examination, you did not get up, you didn't study, you didn't work hard, you were sleeping, you were on your games, you were on your phone, and then you get up, late for the examination, you go there, who is to blame? You want to blame me? Subhanallah. But when you've worked hard, you've done whatever was in your capacity given to you by Allah, then you need to just leave it in the hands of Allah. Oh Allah, whatever you've done for me, I surrender. It's the best thing and it's a good thing. I passed my test. Allah will be happy with you. When Allah tested Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was never upset with Allah. Today we lose our children, may Allah grant those who've lost their children some. And may Allah make those children a means of their entry into Jannah. Say Ameen. Ameen. Today when we lose our children, what happens? We become people who question Allah. Oh Allah, why did you do this to me? Allah says, hey, I gave you the child in the first place. I love the child more than you. I wanted the child with me. What are you getting angry for? Subhanallah. You don't question Allah's decree. It's Allah's decree. It's part of Iman. Today when you lose something, you know, an accident happens, you lose a limb, Allah says, God of us, someone's struggling with their health, don't question Allah. Someone's struggling in their marriages, don't question Allah. A lot of times we are guilty of making life difficult for our spouses. I want to take another promise from you guys tonight. Can I do it? Those of you who are married, promise Allah that you will be the source of the coolness of the eyes of your spouse. Make life easy and good and beautiful for your spouse. Is that a good enough promise? That was quite a soft amen. Is that a good enough promise? Yes, mashallah, amen, inshallah. So now, remember you're promising Allah that when you go home, you're going to be the best possible person to your spouse. Why do I make you promise this tonight in the house of Allah? And you're going to be questioned about it. There might be people from amongst us who've got marital issues. If you want it, you won't be able to do it. Allah says it in the Quran. If both of you intend to solve the problem, Allah will grant you the acceptance to sort it out. But if one doesn't want to sort it out, you're not going to sort it out. You understand? Go home. Be the best person to your spouse, because charity begins at home. You go home, you must be the coolest person ever. You must be the sweetest guy. You must be the loveliest woman ever. Why? Because the hadith says, Khayrukum, Khayrukum Ya'ayyu. The best from amongst you are those who are the best. To who? To your family members, to your spouse, to your wife. The best of you. Now you know if you look at the Arabic language, the term used is khayrukum khayrukum bi ahli. Now an ahli, it refers to a few things, right? Primarily the spouse. So when you're translating in English, you know what you say? The best of amongst you are those who are your wives. Now there is plural and wives is plural. So you say the best of amongst you are those who are best to their wives. And I've had wives young men who go home and say, "Did you hear what the sheikh says?" So the woman says, "Yes." He says, "You must be the best to your wives. Here I am, I'm your wife." He says, "No, you missed the point. It was the S." Come on, we're talking about being kind to who's at home. That's what we're saying, being the best. Don't be a cheat, don't be silly, don't be an adulterer, don't be someone who commits major sins, goes home and expects your spouse to digest it from you. No, today is the day we're going to change all that. Because why? The Prophet ﷺ, whom we love the most, says, the best from amongst you, those who are best to your wives. SubhanAllah. So I think that promise was good enough. It's in Fima Atlihi, meaning it's in the right place because we want to be the best. That's the reason why I make you promise, and I promise that too. I'm sure if you go to my house, you might hear a good answer, inshallah. I hope so, inshallah. Because when I ask my family members, "Do you think I'm a good guy?" They say, "Oh, very good. You know, really, one of the best, mashallah." But you never know. When that moment someone asks us, "How's the guy?" You might be saying, "You know." So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from among those who are good. I mean, go home, be the best of people. At school, at work, wherever you are, be the best. Be the best. That's what will make you, inshallah, a person who deserves the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's get back to Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. What did he do? He made dua for his dhurriya, for those who were to follow after him. Like I told you, but oh Allah, our offspring, make them on the deen. A lot of us, we don't make dua for our children. How many of us sit and make dua for our children? Are we not guilty? We're so immersed in the worldly life of our own that we think that, you know what, these kids will just grow up without the dua. They will grow up without effort. But we forget, it happens sometimes, we forget the element of supplication. Please call out to Allah for your needs. When you need something and you know, even if it's not a desperate need, but you know it's in the hands of Allah, definitely call out to Him, ask Him, say, "Oh Allah, I thank you. You blessed me with children, give them good health and protect them and give them, you know, make them the coolness of my eyes, make them submitters unto you." Many of us make the dua, "Oh Allah, give my child good health. Oh Allah, make them succeed at school. Oh Allah, help them to get good jobs. Oh Allah, help them to get good salaries. Oh Allah, help them to get good wives. Oh Allah, help them to get this." And we forget to make dua, "Oh Allah, make them good Muslims." We forget that dua. "Oh Allah, make them good Muslims. وَمِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِنَا أُمَّةً مُسْلِمَةً لَكَ." Make them supporters unto you, oh Allah. Allah loves that dua. It shows a concern. Wallahi, when you are concerned, half the problem is gone. If you have a concern, too concerned about something, half the matter is resolved by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam. As a favor unto him, Allah gave him something unique. Do you know what it was? The prophets who came after him were all from his family. Subhanallah. What a gift of Allah. Just the concern he had, the worry, that concern, the dua that he kept making to Allah. Allah says, "You know what, Ibrahim? You are my friend. اتخذ الله إبراهيم خليلا." You are my friend. The prophets are going to be from your family. Now you look at the prophets coming all the way down from the family of Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. My brothers, my sisters, you know, prophethood is over with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Come and make dua, "Oh Allah, make my child a pious child." SubhanAllah. If you want that child to achieve some form of piety and obedience unto Allah, guess what? You need to start with yourself. You need to start with yourself. How do you talk to people? How do you dress? What is your relationship with the Quran? What's your relationship with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam sunnah? Do you read it? Do you give it importance? Or are you a person who's far away, but you're just making it now, "Allah, I'm far, but my children keep them close"? No, that doesn't work that way. How can you say that, "Oh Allah, you know, with me it's okay, I might not read salah, but my children, ya Allah, make sure that they, you know, help them to be regular with salah"? I tell you, if you make an effort in one direction, Allah has given a power, automatic sense of respect and position to parents that they don't even know they have sometimes. When your children at an early age watch you, when they just look at you and see you do something, they automatically want to mimic, they want to follow, they want to copy. If you read
read Salah, read human being, I swear by Allah, your child who cannot even speak will want to come and sujood with you when you go down. I swear if you dress in a specific way, your kids will want to dress just like you and they will fight to dress like you. Who gave them that? Allah. It's a fitrah. It's something inside. To copy parents and to mimic them is a gift Allah gave parents without them realizing the power of sometimes. So that's why I pick it up and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you, and by His will, bi-ibnillah, He will open the doors. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, one after the other. Let's take a look at some of the children. So he has Ismail alayhi salam. Ismail alayhi salam was brought up in such a beautiful way. Such a beautiful way. That whenever his father had to do something for the sake of Allah, there was never objection. Because they knew that this is the instruction of Allah. Okay? So I had a case some years back where there was a woman who was complaining of the husband never being at home. So I asked, I said, so where does he go? She says, I don't know. He makes an excuse to say, I'm going to the masjid. But he goes to the masjid from Fajr and he comes back after Salat al-Isha. Now, I was a little bit, you know, surprised. I said, this man is a good man. It seems like he's a good man. Where is he going? What is he doing? So I decided to meet him, brother, you know, don't feel bad, but you know, I think you need to spend a bit more time at home. She says, no. He says, no. What are you talking about? Have you changed? You know the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam? I said, yes. What about it? Now, I don't know which way the story is going. I have no idea what he's about to say. He says, you see, I read that Ibrahim alayhi salam told his wife and his child that I'm going because Allah told me to go. And they said, go. So he says, I want my family to be just like that. They must submit. When Ibrahim alayhi salam, I said, brother, number one, you're not Ibrahim alayhi salam. Number two, Allah did not tell him to just go, leave them, just say go, and they must help you home. It doesn't work that way anymore. You know, have you ever heard a story about when Ibrahim alayhi salatu was salam visited Mecca? Very interestingly. And he went to the house, according to the narration mentioned by Ibn Kathir rahimahullah, and he says he went to the house of Ismail alayhi salam. Ismail alayhi salam was not there. So he asks a question, he knocks the door was opened by the spouse, he asks a question about that. Where's your husband? And she didn't know who's this old man. And she had a bad words to say, ah, you know, she said something negative. So he says, okay, when he comes back, just tell him that such and such an old man was here. And he says, you know, you need to change your door, you know, like the doormat or the door, right? So she says, okay, when she came back, he asks, anyone visited? So the wife says, yes, there was an old man, and he asked me this question, that question. Then he says, when your husband comes back, tell him to change his doormat. So Ismail alayhi salam says, you know what? That was my father. And guess what? He's asked me to divorce you. Whoa. Now, you know, that's a serious story, because, you know, that's a prophet of Allah. We can't question that, right? It's a serious story, right? It's a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah definitely has inspired him to do that. He did it for whatever reason. He visited after some time, and that time there was another wife, and Ismail alayhi salam was not at home, and the same thing happened, and he was impressed by the response of this woman who had no complaints. She said some good words, so he said, tell him to keep your door or your doormat. So when the husband came back, he found out that this is what the old man said, and he says, that was my father, and he was happy with what you had to say. He said, keep your wife. So now, today, you have certain parents who tell their children when they've got no problem with their wives or anything going wrong, listen, divorce your wife. Why? Because myself and your mother, we've got a problem with her. But dad, I love her. Hey, don't you know the story of Ibrahim alayhi salam? Allah says you must derive a lesson from the story. Allahu Akbar. So when that, wallahi, that type of a case has come to me. Wallahi, I'm not joking. It has come to me. And you know what I told him? I said, brother, you are not Ibrahim alayhi salam. The day you are a prophet of Allah, you can talk. Because that story does not make sense to me either. That a father must come and instruct his son to divorce the wife when the two of them may not have a problem. That's for an appeal of Allah. If there was something really happening and we're sitting here, we're advising, and there is a major disaster, and the father says, look, I have a feeling maybe you guys should separate. That's a different issue. There's nothing wrong. How many of us are guilty here of interfering in the lives of our children who are married? Sometimes we think we have the right. Why? Because Ibrahim alayhi salam said this. No. You're not a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot come in and start dictating in the wrong way. We solve the problems. We try our best to resolve matters. The first line of advice is never to say, just break the marriage. Just go home. Just quit. It's never that. It's always to say, listen, try and make it work. Make amends. Forgive each other. Have a big heart, etc., etc. Yes, if it is extreme oppression and so on, it's a different matter. But the point I'm raising here is, when we draw lessons from the stories of the prophets, we should never come up with something negative like this and just claim, no, he did it, I can do it. You're not a prophet of Allah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us peace. So Ismail alayhi salam brought up in such a beautiful way that the day his father came to him and told him, إني أرى في المنام أني أذبحك فانظر ماذا ترى قال يا أبت افعل ما تؤمر ستجدني إن شاء الله من الصابرين. He comes and he tells his son, oh my son, I had a dream. Allah instructed me to sacrifice you, subhanAllah. The son looked at him and said, you know what, dad? Do as you've been instructed, inshallah, you'll find me to be patient. Allahu Akbar. The child was brought up in such a unique way that when he knew this was the obedience of Allah, he did not object. He didn't object. We don't have it so hard. We don't have it so difficult. But the way we bring our children up sometimes, we use the word love, L-O-V-E. As an excuse to buy them everything they want and to do everything they want to do, even if it is dangerous and detrimental. We haven't even guided them sometimes. I know of some parents, whatever keeps the child quiet, they just give the child. Why? Because just let them play. It's okay. I'm okay. You know? Even if it is something bad, sometimes there is a game that might be detrimental. Sometimes an addiction is developed to the television such that, you know what, you put your child in front of the TV with a remote and you go away. You can go away for 6 hours. The child will be happy, you know, playing and clicking and seeing whatever they're watching, and you're so excited doing your own thing. You might even disappear for a while, come back and you see the child in the same place. I tell you what, you need to know what limits are. Whatever you have given your child, you need to know to teach the child the limits of it. What's right, what's wrong. You need to learn to teach your children how to use things that have been given to them. They need to be responsible. I have a policy. If you do this, you will get that. If you do that, you will get this. Subhanallah. You love, for example, your computer game. You love your phone. Well, if you do this much here, you're going to get that phone for 2 hours in the evening. Subhanallah. Amazing. So it's a bargaining tool. Everyone's house is different. There's no blanket rule that works everywhere. But the point I'm raising is, inshallah, we can become a little bit more, inshallah, conscious of how we treat our children by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that was from Ismail alayhi salatu wa salam. And one little point that I raised. Then if you take a look, he had another son called Ishaq. Ishaq alayhi salam had a son called Yaqub. Yaqub alayhi salam had a son called Yusuf. So Yusuf alayhi salam, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam speaks of him very highly. You know why? He was a Nabi, son of a Nabi, son of a Nabi, son of a Nabi. Subhanallah, what a great gift of Allah. Imagine, there's a Prophet of Allah. His father, Prophet of Allah. His father, Prophet of Allah. His father, Prophet of Allah and friend of Allah. Wow. Subhanallah. That's a gift of Allah. And on top of that, he was so handsome. He was so good looking. He was gifted by Allah. Guess what happened to him? Subhanallah. I touched on it yesterday just for a few moments. And then we had to close because the time was up. Right now I've spoken already for 50 minutes almost. Do you realize that? Not 15, 5-0 by the way. Subhanallah. So Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam
gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He went through difficulty upon difficulty upon difficulty upon difficulty, knowing that he's the messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Right at the beginning, he was just a young boy. He just had a dream, and he told his father the dream. And the father told him, don't tell your brothers, because your brothers may become jealous of you. Unfortunately, he told them, they did become jealous, they plotted to kill him, and then they decided, let's not kill him, let us just bury him, or let's throw him into a pit, into a well. They threw him into the well, and guess what happened? He was a young boy. They came back to the father, lying.
وَجَاءُوا عَلَىٰ قَمِيصِهِ بِدَمٍ كَذِبٍ.
They came with false blood on his shirt in the evening. The father knew immediately, these guys are telling me a lie. But he couldn't pinpoint what exactly had happened. Subhanallah. One might say, okay, I just thought of a point right now. Let me pause and say, you see, we all have children. Our children make mistakes, right? They make mistakes. You don't just rule out or throw out your kids because they've made a mistake. You help them, you try. The children of a Nabi of Allah, Yaqub alayhi salam, came back to him, lying to him. And they were his children. Does it mean he brought them up in such a way that they were liars? No. But Shaytan came to them. He did a good job, but Shaytan comes and messes things up. My mothers, my father, sometimes we try our best with our children. But still, when they grow to a certain age, they start doing things that we did not teach them. Maybe they learned it somewhere else. Maybe Shaytan beautified something for them. Don't become too depressed at that. You did your job, you will continue trying, you will continue making dua to Allah. They have now become independent people, answerable to Allah. We will keep trying because we are parents, we will never give up. Some people say, when should I give up? Are you a parent? Yes, don't give up. Keep making dua right up to the end. And keep trying right up to the last moment. I know of drug addicts who had the dirtiest life. They come back with warm tears of tawbah after some time because someone had hope and someone made dua for them and someone kept trying for them. I know of some sheikhs who later became sheikhs, and the beginning of their life was actually quite dark. I know of some of those. How did it happen? Someone worked on them. Someone had hope. Someone tried. Therefore, my brothers, my sisters, no matter what you've done, don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah. Allah is merciful. Allah is merciful. Just be strong. Come back. Come back to Salah. Come back to Allah. And you'll find your doors opening one after the other by His will. Come back to Salah. Salah is something try not to compromise. That's one thing, inshallah, if you have it in place, you will open a lot of beautiful doors by His will, by the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my brothers and sisters, here comes the children of Ya'qub alayhi salam with a lie. They lied to him. That doesn't make him a bad person. No, he wasn't bad. But what happened is, Shaytan deceived them. Now, I will end with this point inshallah. Very interesting point. Again, it's a lesson for those with sound intellect. I said earlier that in our lives, certain things happen that are negative. We suffer loss. Loss in our health. Maybe you might lose a job. You might lose some money. Your investment might pop, for example. You might have lost a limb. You might have lost a loved one. You might be struggling this way, that way. I promise you, bear suffer. Because Yusuf alayhi salam, who was loved by Allah, he went through so many issues. Number one, his brothers were jealous. Number two, they threw him into a pit. Number three, people picked him up and decided to sell him. Number four, the people who sold him, who bought him, decided to accuse him. Number five, the justice system found an innocent man guilty, something he didn't do, and jailed him. Subhanallah. What happened? One after the other, everything started happening negative. He never ever said, Sheikh, I think someone's done that magic on me. You heard that one? That's a famous line. It's a famous line. When one thing went out, the second thing went out, the third thing went out, the fourth thing went out, immediately we start thinking, okay, there's black magic on me. Who do we start blaming? You go to a sheikh, and the sheikh takes two coconuts and starts with this. And a little while later he says, I can see what? It is. And he takes a name, okay? He takes a name, I don't want to state the name because I said it the other day and I regretted it, okay? But anyway, he takes a name, right?
And what do you do? You say yes. Sometimes they say it's someone in your own family. That's a famous statement. You know why? Shaitan's main job is to destroy the family. And every single extended family has some form of politics. It's impossible to have an extended family of about 10, 15 and there's everything is, you know, sweet. There has to be one or two small cracks here and there. It's normal. So Shaitan comes and chisels in the cracks and yeah, someone in the family, and you start thinking, yeah, I know I did have a problem with this guy anyway. I'm sure, yeah, that's it. So what happened? You are in the trap of the devil. Don't do that. Yusuf alayhi salam never ever blamed the king or Shaitan or Sihr or anything of that nature. He knew this is Shaitan. You know what he says? وقد جاء بكم من البدر من بعد أن نزغ الشيطان بيني وبين إخوتي. Right at the end, when they came together, he says, I'm so thankful to Allah who brought us together after Shaitan had split us. Who did he blame? Shaitan. You know, as mu'mineen, we're so lucky we've got someone to blame. You know, if you yell and scream that you did something wrong at home, all you gotta do is go and say, Assalamu alaikum, guys, I'm so sorry, you know, that was Shaitan. And they say, yes, it was Shaitan, mashallah, you know. We've got someone to blame. The problem is we come up and we don't even want to blame Shaitan. You know why? We are little shayateen ourselves sometimes. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not let that happen. So my brothers and sisters, this is something unique. It's something amazing that a mu'min has. We know that it's the devil that makes us do bad. I always say that people are good, Shaitan is bad. I'm sure you might have heard me say that. People are good, but Shaitan is bad. When Shaitan overtakes you and attacks you, you need to understand, you need to get out of there as soon as possible. Get out of there as soon as possible, because he will trap you. The longer you are in his clutch, the more difficult it is to come out. So as soon as you did something wrong, come back to Allah. As soon as you did something wrong, come back to Allah. Don't allow yourself to go deeper and deeper into that sin, because then it will become more difficult to come out of that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for us. So here is Yusuf alayhi salatu wa salam. One after the other, so many bad things happened. And right in the end, guess what happened? The people who planned his downfall, they were the ones who came begging to him. Right? Allah raised him above those who tried to drop him. Because raising someone is in the hands of Allah. So when someone tries hard to tarnish your image, ignore it. Don't worry. If you do something positive about it. Don't become negative. Because do you know what? Allah will give you a day when you will see what will be the result of their plot. وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرَ اللَّهِ. They plot and Allah is the one who plans against them. And who is the best of planners? Allah. So when negative things happen, bear patience. When someone tries to plot against you, bear patience. What will happen? A day of victory will definitely come for you. And you will see it. And Allah will grant you the smile of that day. Yusuf alayhi salam, it's reported that it was almost 40 years, according to some narrations. And then what happened? He saw the victory. His brothers came in. And I want to end with that same point that I said I would end with, where he looks at the sadness in the face of his brothers. And they told him, يا أيها العزيز مسنا وأهلنا الضر وجئنا ببضاعة مزجاة فأوف لنا الكيل وتصدق علينا إن الله يجزي المتصدقين. They came with a sad story. They told him, oh Aziz, you know, he was now the minister. Yusuf alayhi salam was high above these guys. He was in charge of the granaries. He was the minister, the main man in charge. They said, you know what? Our family is suffering. Now he couldn't hear that. You know why? It's his family. Our family is struggling. We are going through a very tough time. Have mercy on us. We brought you some little wealth. We want you to give us a little bit of produce and have mercy on us. Be charitable. He couldn't.
question. قال هل علمتم ما فعلتم بيوسف وأبيه إذ أنتم جاهلون. He says, you know what? I want to ask you guys a question. Do you know what you guys did to Yusuf and his brother while you were ignorant? Now, he's finding an excuse for them. In antum jahilun, that's an excuse. You say, when you guys did not really know what you were doing, do you know what you actually did? They were shocked and stunned. The reason why they were stunned is because they knew that, okay, the story of the brother of Yusuf, perhaps maybe few people might know it because he was Binyamin, and you know, but the story of Yusuf, no one knows it. No one. So this can only be him, no one else. Zero. They kept it within themselves. So they looked at him. They looked at him again. And they says, إِنَّكَ لَأَنْتَ يُوسُف. Is it that you are Yusuf? Wow. Now was the time of the truth. He could jail them, he could punish them, he could execute them, he could display retribution. Anything could happen on that day. He's in power. And these people who tried to kill him initially, they were all there in front of him. His brothers. You know what he says? أَنَا يُوسُفُ وَهَذَا أَخِي قَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا. He didn't even want to hear what they had to say. He said, I'm Yusuf, this is my brother, Allah has favored us. Wow. I don't want to hear about the negatives on this day. I don't want to hear about what you guys did. I actually want to tell you the favors of Allah upon us. Wow. And they were shocked. They were just looking. They didn't know. God smacked. What do I say? What do we say? Tallahi laqad atharaka Allahu alayna wa in kunna khatiin. They said, we swear by Allah that Allah has definitely raised you above us. We were taught to be wrong in what we did. You know what he says? لا تثريب عليكم اليوم يغفر الله لكم وهو أرحم الراحمين. There will be no retribution against you, you are my brothers. There will be no retribution against you today. Allah will forgive you, for indeed He is the most merciful, the most forgiving. Subhanallah. How many of us can tell that to our own brothers and sisters? We have not been communicating with our brothers, our sisters, our parents, our uncles, our aunts for years on end for something petty, for a little bit of money, for a small misunderstanding. Today is the day. Go and resolve the matter, come what may. It's too much. We cannot go on like this. We are brothers and sisters. What did you learn from Yusuf alayhi salam? He tells the people, subhanAllah, la tathriba alaykum al-yawm. You know what, my brothers, for 40 years you separated me from my family. For 40 years you did a lot of harm. But I want to tell you today, no retribution. I still love you. Go home, go and see our father, take this shirt, bring everyone back, come and enjoy here. Who would do that? We are not ready to do that with our own brothers. We have a problem of $1,000, alas, my brother, no more my brother. Don't ever come back to me. That's how we operate. Let's sort our matters out. What did you learn? And after those verses, that is when Allah says, لَقَدْ كَانَ فِي قَصَصِهِمْ عِبْرَةٌ لِأُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Indeed, in the stories of these messengers are lessons for those with sound knowledge. Look at Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the day of Quraysh, the day of the victory of Makkah. He went into Makkah with the whole army in front of those who had persecuted them for so many years. And he asks them a question, knowing they knew very well that this man has come to us with superior power. He has come to us with thousands of men and he has marched into Makkah. We harmed them, we persecuted them for years on end. And here we are standing in front of him. He can do what he wants with us. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, says, Ya ma'ashara Quraysh, ma'ma tadunnuna anni fa'ilun bikum. O people of Quraysh, what do you really think I'm going to do to you today? And obviously they are looking, they are worried, they are concerned. They are very concerned because they know this man could do anything. But they were hoping good because Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a great man. He says to them, I am going to tell you what my brother Yusuf told his brothers. لا تثريب عليكم اليوم. No retribution against you today. اذهبوا فأنتم ملقى. Every one of you, you can go
You are all free. There will be no retribution. We have forgiven you for what you've done. That's the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Today we have a disease. For the smallest difference, we hate on each other. The smallest difference, we hate on each other. We call each other names. We want to hit each other, destroy each other, harm each other. Let's change that inshallah for the sake of Allah, and we will become the best of people. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us an asset not only to the ummah, but to humanity at large.